Okay, so what I'll try to do today is to finalize all the issues that I want to discuss under case study and under qualitative research. So I'll continue from where we left off the last time. We were discussing how we collect qualitative data. Then we also discussed how we identify the different data techniques. We talked about interviews, we talked about focus group discussions, and we talked about observation. So today what I'll try to do is to look at how we do sampling. Sampling in the sense that where will you collect the data itself? How do you sample members of the population to fit the type of study you are trying to do in qualitative? Okay, so sampling is just a process of selecting samples from a group or a population. Now, whenever you are doing any research, you are targeting a given population. Let's say you want to do a research on market women in Accra, but you cannot interview every single market woman in Accra. So you need to take a sample out of the given set. And where will you select your sample from? These are some of the questions that we are going to try to understand today. And sampling is a process of selecting samples from a group of population to become the foundation for estimating and predicting the outcome of the study over a given population. So when we try to study the sample, we try to understand the sample so that we can be able to say that this is what happens on generalized towards the population. But we have to be very careful. Quantitative studies, you try to do statistical sampling and statistical generalization. They pick a sample that is very representative of the given population and they try to generalize towards the population. Whilst qualitative studies try to do what we call theoretical or strategic sampling, what they try to do in that sense is they make sure that the sample fits the purpose of the study. So, and then it can help explain what the outcomes are, not necessarily over the given population. For example, if I'm trying to do a study on what students eat, a qualitative study can just try to establish that there are three types of food the students eat. But he will not try to find out what proportion of the students only eat tuzafi or only eat fried rice or only eat garri and beans. I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. But a quantitative study may go beyond just identifying the four to be able to tell you what proportion of the population are likely to be eating either of these foods. Now, a sample is a subset of a given population. We make conclusions on a population by studying or investigating the particular sample that we select. A population is any complete group or set of entities that we want to explore, understand, or predict. These are the why we do research, exploration, and then we have got descriptive and also predictive and sometimes explanatory. So from a sample, we select a sample from our population and then we study the sample to be able to make an inference on the population. So to be able to do that, we usually have what we call the sampling frame. Let's take the University of Ghana as an example. University of Ghana has a number of students, almost about 30,000 students. 36,000 students, okay, that's quite a lot. Now, if I want to do a sample, I select a sample from it. I could actually select a sample from the business school. I hope you understand. But that would just give me just a list of students in the business school or a sample that's made up of just the business school. But I want to make it representative. So my sampling frame becomes the list of all the elements or all the students in the University of Ghana by going to the Dean of Students to produce the list for me. Now, that list is what we call the working population, the population that is accessible to me. It's likely that there could be a student who is in the University of Ghana who may not be in that list because he has not paid the school fees. Or that particular semester, that student has deferred that semester. So that student is not in the list. But so the working population is what we call the accessible population. That makes up your sampling frame. Even if my population was a business school, the working population would be the list of students in a business school. If my population was this class, the working population could be the list of students in the class. If a student, per chance, a student is having a problem with the class prefect like Ben, and then Ben decides not to write his name, that student is not part of my working population, but he's part of the actual population. So your working population is the list of people in the sampling frame, which some people have referred to them as the accessible population. That is the one that is accessible to you. I hope you can appreciate it. Yeah. Now, For there are two categories of sampling. You've got probability sampling and non-probability sampling. For probability sampling, we always have a known probability of choosing an element, or what, a non-zero probability of choosing an element. Now let's take a die as an example. A die, an even die, not an uneven die, an even faced die, an evenly faced die, has six sides. Now if I roll the die, it's likely that one face will show up. So each of the faces has one out of six chances of showing up. Is that not true? That's a known probability. So that would be what we would call probability sampling. But a non-probability sampling is the one that the probability of selecting any of the elements is not known at the beginning of the study. If I say do a propositive sampling of people who own golf four, you cannot know that from your off-head from Ghana. So it's going to be more of a non-probability sampling approach. Now, and underneath each of them, they have got different types of sampling. So I always, when students are doing their study and they write that I'm using my type of sampling approach is probability sampling, it doesn't really tell us anything. Get it right. It doesn't really tell us anything. It doesn't tell us which of the techniques within non-probability sampling approach you are using. So we are more interested in which of the techniques underneath these that you are going to use. Now, in quantitative studies, you are drawn towards probability sampling, and with qualitative studies, you are drawn towards non-probability sampling. The reason is, with qualitative studies, it's not about representativeness. It's much more about the fact that that what you choose can help us understand what we want to study, and it's more focused on enhancing our understanding, and then can be able to give us what is relevant towards the parameters you are trying to study or the factors you are trying to study. So if I say I'm trying to study, let's say in the UNESCO, there's a project called Teachers Living with AIDS, where they have some type of interventions to be able to help these teachers. Now, to be able to sample them, then you should have an idea of what is going on. So it has to be purposive. You can't just say random, are you living with AIDS? Are you living with AIDS? It will not help you. Is that not true? Good. In the same way, a set of students 2 years ago were doing a study on mobile phones and prostitution in Ghana. And when they finished the study and they presented it before the class, the students were asking, how do you collect your data? And they were saying they were using probability, the purposive sampling, which is a non-probability sample. But after digging through it, we realized that one of the students was working in an NGO that actually interfaces with prostitutes and advises them and gives some information to them. So in that case, it was very easy for them to do probability purposive sampling, because they could just go and select those people who could fit their study. Now, one other student was asking whether they could have used a non-probability sampling approach, like random sampling, where you go to where? See, only the men are answering the questions. Where you go to where? It was a trick question. You see that I was just watching who answered the question. Where you go to the supposedly red light district in Accra, and then go and start asking questions. Are you? Now you know that could end up bringing trouble for you. Anyway, but if I was a person doing a study like that, I would just go through the same method the students did, or go to agencies like the hospitals that are fertility clinics, or you go to some of the projects that I have got interventions, social interventions for reproduction and for sexual behavior, especially like PPAG, the Planned Parenthood Association of Ghana. These are some of the institutions that you could interface with or even interact with. They can give you some direction. Good. I'll come to your snowballing. So, quite. Is it because I was discussing prostitution? Everybody wants to ask a question.
You said that non-probability is usually school to qualitative research. And then the probability is for quantity. I was just asking if you could. It's vice versa. As in, I'm conducting a quantitative study, but I'm using a positive sample.
It could be. I've seen people use quantitative study, I use a positive sample. But you see, you are still selecting to face a minimum number of elements to be able to make a generalization on the population. You are still not going to compromise on the number that will be sufficient for to satisfy statistical analysis. The first fact that you are doing purposely does not mean that you are still not going to do a minimum of 100, depending on the statistical methods you are going to use. You are still going to satisfy all the other requirements of or of what that will be fit your study, your quantitative study. So the difficulty is whenever you choose your sampling approach, you have to start thinking about how you're going to analyze. They all go hand in hand. Because some sampling approach, quantitative techniques require you to have a minimum of some number of elements in your sample before, not elements that are just interviewed, elements that you have actually received data from. You know that in quantitative studies, if I want 250, I may have to do maybe some percentage more. Some people argue that you have to do a minimum of 25% more, so that by plus or minus, you may be able to get around the figure of that you're looking for. So if I was doing 200, I may have to do about 225 or about 250, so that when I remove all the non-response questions, I can still get for each question, get it right, for each question on my questionnaire, I have a minimum of about 190 on it, so that I can satisfy my analysis. Sometimes you think you should have only 200 questionnaires, and I got 200 questionnaires back, all of them, almost 100% answered. But 100% returned, but doesn't mean 100% answered. You can have some 2 questions or 3 questions in which you have less than 50% answering, which still bring affect, if it's critical to your analysis, it's going to affect the whole thing. Maybe if you're doing a pilot, that can give an idea that question, either there's something wrong with the question, or you should, or drop the question. Thank you.
The issue of, apart from the purposive sampling, come back to the prostitution HIV issue. And you said you could go to, let's say, Planned Parenthood or any fertility clinic. Do you consider data protection laws?
Oh, anybody who is doing research that will, in the university, I need to cover things that are ethical and sensitive. You are supposed to sign an ethical consent form, and you submit it to the university's research. Is the Office for Research and Innovation and Development? That's all right. Yeah. Yes, you have to go there and fill one and submit that. And if there are some potential issues of privacy, you'll be advised on it, what you can do and what you cannot do, so that you can protect yourself in university. Just that in the business school, we don't do much of that, apart from those who are in the health services. But still in the business school, others in public sector and public administration do what we call elite interviews. Interviews with politicians, interviews with people of higher authority. No, I'm not talking about CEOs. I'm talking about political authority, which can also affect your work. So, and they are quite sensitive. Hence, you need to also go for a clearance. We don't have much time, but you think you want to read on this elite interviews. It's a whole course, and there are write-ups on it that you can actually read on them, how to conduct elite interviews. Okay. Now let's get into it. Non-probability sampling is what we'll start with, because that is what is primarily important to us as qualitative researchers. Okay, this is technique is based on non-random selection approach. You cannot just randomize. Yes.
Qualitative research, you could use observations. What if I get a clip from, let's say, Metro TV, or a sound recorded something from a politician, or maybe Joy FM, and I want to use it for analysis?
You are going to state the source.
Yes.
You're going to state the source. Okay, it depends on what you are using it for. In all qualitative research, any source of data that is substantiating key arguments, you have to know that you have got all the rights to be able to use them. But if it's just supportive, let me just give you an example. You are doing a study and you are studying the impact on branding on cars in Ghana, sales of cars in Ghana. And you happen to go and take refer to the fact that according to SEPs, there is a law or an act that states that cars that are more than 10 years old, which are important to the country, should attract some penalty. Now, supposing you don't have the, there is some revision to the law, but it may not be written, but it was in an interview on City FM, and you want to quote it from that, you can quote from that and just support it with that, with a transcript in your appendix. I hope you understand me. So it's just an add-on. But if you are saying that there was fraud, there is fraud in DVLA, and that is a categorical statement like that, and you heard it from somebody, and you said that, and you want to use it for your arguments, I will advise you that go and get permission before you put it inside. I hope you understand. To what extent is, in fact, it all has to do with all referencing. I think if you watch the referencing video, I mentioned that it's whatever you are using to substantiate arguments, you have to know what at what level or to what extent does it become the very basis of your argument. Argumentation, did Dr. Ifa teach you?
Okay. But the issue of, for example, when you conduct an interview, the person says lots of things and then later on tells you that, for this one, please, don't use it.
Yeah.
For example, the case of Miss Bell, he said he doesn't believe in Jesus Christ, believes in God. But then it became a big issue, and now it says that the album she released, nobody buy, because of the views. And then she said, she told the DJ or whoever that for that part, she was just saying it for them, but not for the public. But then they feel that it's a big news, and they release it.
Okay. You see, do you remember the definition of research? Your question was about the fact that sometimes some respondents may say something and they don't want you to use them in a particular way that you want to use them. Okay. But let me answer your question with the example that you're giving on a Ghanaian musician who says something, she wants to retract it. Okay. Remember what I said earlier, that research is finding answers, an organized and systematic way of finding answers to questions. And I told you that the word systematic means that the research has to adhere to certain principles or procedures which are dictated by a particular scientific body that the researcher belongs to. For journalistic writing, there may be an issue there. So, but if you are in a business school, social science, and you are doing the research, and you go out and go and interview somebody, and the person tells you categorically you can't use something, you have to follow the ethical, form that concern form that you have signed, that you cannot be able to use what the person has said don't use. Now, if you find that one to be a new finding that you want to bring out, then you have to find out that same information from somebody else other than the person who is saying that don't use it. Because you are breaching some of your own research ethics by using an information that was not obtained through a due process. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? But with journalistic writing and investigation, there are certain dimensions which may not necessarily apply here. And the focus in which the presenter may go on and still play it because of whatever he wants to get, the commercial incentives in it are very different. I hope you understand me. Now, for your research, you only gain value if it is published by a scientific journal and accepted by the scientific audience, not by Ghanaians. But for a journalist, maybe he gains audience if Ghanaians or general public just embraces the research. So you see that who you are communicating your research to differ. I hope you understand me. And we even recommend that when you finish collecting your data, you transcribe, you need to take it back to the respondent to check whether what he said or she put across, you have been able to capture it very well, because there are the biases that qualitative researchers we all have. The fact that we come so close to the data, we can even interpret it in the way we think, but that's not what is really happening. Do you agree with that? Okay. So we have haphazard sampling, snowballing, purposive, and deviant. There are a number of other ones, but these are the common ones that you may likely to use. Convenient sampling approach means it's quite haphazard. You do it within your convenience. Like I asked you to do a study on students' perceptions on the watches other students wear. Very interesting study. But then what will you do? You just stand by a classroom and start looking at everybody's watch. That's not true. Good. Or I asked a question on financing practices of young professionals. you don't want to go far. You stand in the classroom and just collect data from here. So that means that you are doing convenience within your convenience. But convenience sampling can also be biased. The reason why it can be biased is that sometimes there are other aspects, other data that could be shared or findings that could be obtained from people who are not in the unique subset that you have selected. That subset can be biased towards a particular viewpoint. For example, if I'm doing the young professionals, I'm looking at financial practices, and averagely everybody here is earning below 2,000 Ghana cedis. Their financial practices will be very different from somebody who is earning above 2,000 cedis. So if you don't take care, my study will be skewed towards those who are only earning below 2,000 cedis, which does not, there could be young professionals who are earning more than that. So it doesn't actually give me a holistic perspective of what I'm trying to collect data on. I hope you can appreciate it. Hence, it is better that you go beyond convenience sampling. But the truth to be told, we all kind of sometimes lean on this because of the limitations of research, budget-wise, time-wise, resource constraints. Make something can actually tell you that you can't go far. So what can you do? Do convenience. So another one interesting way you see convenience sampling is when the radio stations want to get perspectives of people concerning an economic issue, a political issue, a social issue. They just come out of the radio station, stand in front of the gates, and they start asking questions that, what do you think about this? What do your viewpoint about that? Now can you just imagine if there's a demonstration going on? Everybody working in front of the radio station may have one type of opinion towards the issue. Another way that people do is to have it as a questionnaire in the newspapers. But today, quite a number of people don't even read newspapers. Even if they read it, they don't buy it and they own it so that they can cut it. They read other friends' own or people's own on in their offices. Or they what they do is that they will check the news online. So the news, almost all the news in the newspapers is almost old. So they are not. They are not required by any particular reason. They are not informed by any particular reason to buy a newspaper. So when you put your questionnaire in the newspaper, that means that you are having only a few people who can buy it. Or those who respond to it are skewed toward those who purchase and own it. You can't just get up and take somebody's newspaper and cut it into news and cut a questionnaire out of it.
I've seen it done at the library.
People cut it. Okay. Now, purposive sampling is what we are all leaning towards. As an experienced individual, selects a sample based on his or her judgment about some appropriate characteristics required for the sample. So you want to make sure that all those who are doing who are in your sample have this and they have that. For example, you are doing a study on SMEs, and you want to make sure that all those who are in it have more than 5 employees to qualify for the meaning of SME, because SME is the World Bank definition, 5 and more. And then below 20. So you say between 5 to 20 employees, that may be what you want to say. Secondly, you may want to say that those who have been in operation, in business operation for not less than 48 months, because in Africa or in West Africa, the statistics says that SMEs usually don't stay beyond 42 months. So you want to say that at least I should have been in operation for at least 48 months. That could be one. Then you could also have another factor that could also be should be in who are in SMEs who are into agroforestry business. So you have stated certain criteria, and that means that you have to go and select to fit those appropriate characteristics. So the study starts with you setting up some characteristics, and these characteristics can come from your research framework or can come from some elements you want to try to study, or can even come from your research gaps. For example, if there's all the studies that have been done on extractive industries in Ghana have been on gold, you may want to do it on bauxite. So it means that from day one, you are looking at only bauxite companies. You don't want to go and interview. The reason why you interview a company which is into gold is to find out maybe you began with bauxite and you left it to gold, or you began with gold and left to bauxite. So you want to know why that person left. Or you want to get their perception, whether as a person who is mining in gold, one day will you move into bauxite? I hope you can appreciate that. Because of the fact that we have selected that we want our study on extractive industry, but bauxite, we want to make sure that all the firms that are in the study are on what are dealing with bauxite extraction. Okay. Now, another thing is that most of these... this type of sampling approach is used for cases that are sometimes very difficult to come by randomization. If you just want to use random, you might not get anybody. So it's better you have use a purposive sampling. So if I was doing a study on people who own golf, the best thing for me to do is to purposively go to Vodi Technics or a company that sells Volvo, or repair a garage that repairs VW, and find out that those who are, which of your members or your list of clients own a golf. So very purposive from the beginning. Now, if you're able to find one, the next person can be what referred to you, and that takes us to snowballing. Snowballing is a multi-stage sampling approach in which the first person is either found by random sampling or by purposive sampling, but the next person is found by referrals. So the first person will be given to you either by randomization or by purposive sampling. The next person, then you go to the next person by referral. So they keep referring you. And when they refer you, you find the next person. But by the time you realize, it's just like the concept of a snowball. When you throw it and as it rolls, it grows bigger. Ben, is it true? You went to Canada, or where did you go to? UK or US? Did you see snow? Or you saw it in a magazine? Maybe just for pictures. Ghanaian in a summer weather but wearing winter jacket. It's possible because it was too cold for him. Everybody knows. You're a researcher. Are you really sure? Some people know. But it's not every state in the US. If you're in Louisiana, you not have snow. Anyway. Now, the last part is what we call deviant sampling. Deviant sampling is a type of sampling approach which we use to find outliers or outliers. Now, who are they? Everybody is getting 50 over 100, and one person gets 80. So you want to find out why that person got 80. So outliers are these type of people we want to study. Yeah.
Snowboarding. Some institutions that you might even find it difficult to get the first person. And that if you find the first or two, you are not likely to get more than that. So do you continue or you get your condition achieve that?
Okay. Some point does not mean that you should find only the first person as one. You may find the first person and then get only to end up on the third one. Then you find another set of people to start again. You see, whenever you have an issue, let me give you an example. You're saying some institution, if I have a topic on EPA, like something on the environment, and EPA is the only institution I have to interview, you know that technically I may only have only about three people there. They may give me access to about only just three people, and you have to end there. But you also have to sometimes think about the fact that the topic is your topic phrased in such a manner that it embraces other people who work with EPA. For example, we are saying that getting environmental license for extractive industries is difficult in Ghana, and you want to do a study on that. So you go and interview EPA. When I finish, I'll interview the experiences of the different extractive companies. I hope you understand me, so that I can build a very rich picture of the issue. Qualitative data does not always mean that you should only talk to the only person who has gone through it. We're supposed to do an exercise, but we jammed it earlier last week. But let me give you, every time I do this exercise, just to be able to give students an idea of how far you can go. Let's give an example. Supposing you're writing a paper on contemporary marketing practices by Ghanaian musicians, and you're doing a case study of Shatawale, for example. Now, where will you begin your interview from? Who? You begin with, okay, let's say, collecting qualitative data. So there are four forms of qualitative data. So let's start. With the interviews, we start with who? Shatta himself. Then who again?
His management.
Then who again?
His fans.
Okay. Then who again? Musica. Good. Then who is it? You see, Musica is not internal, it's external. But that's good, yes.
DJs.
Those who sell the CDs. Okay.
The DJs.
Good. And then the journalists. Yes, there's one more, there are quite about two.
They're pastors.
okay, that could also be, yeah, that could also be, that will, okay, we can add all of them to the musical group. Yes. And then what again? Oh, yeah, that's his management. Yeah.
Those who don't believe in his form of music, I mean.
Okay, okay, that could be true. Samini could be true. Yes.
Competitors,
yes. Yes, that the music awards, yes. So you're missing some people. Okay, you see, you're coming from finance and accounting. You're thinking about whether he pays tax. Okay, but there's something which is more closer, and you have forgotten that part. His wife, good, and then who again? The father. He talks so much more about his father, so his father too is part of it. Okay, now we finish. What about his old school? Where he attended school, his educational background, where he grew up, Nima and other towns that he has grown up in. These are people can give you real data about them. So we are finished with interviews. Let's take another one. Audiovisual, where will you get information? Radio stations, about what? What are you looking for from there? So what are you looking for from there? What audiovisual information do you want? No, radio and TV is not, is the source, it's not the actual data.
Before you go there, I just have to buy you like this. You didn't.
Let me finish this one first.
Okay.
His clips, the video clips. Good. So you can watch the clips and can look at descriptions from it, the people he puts inside, what he depicts in the videos, and then even the lyrics of the songs can be done. Yes. What else?
YouTube,
good. So YouTube will also give you information from both fans and people. And then what again? Facebook.
So
Twitter accounts, yes, can give you discussions. You see, this is a real work that happens in real life, that if you are doing collecting data for qualitative research, you can go that far. Beyond that, now we are getting to documents. What are you going to look for? Yes, what are documentation do you need? Magazines of what? Musical. But that, what has it got to do with him?
Entertainment news
concerning him, yes. From where?
From showbiz.
Graphic showbiz, yes. Google is not the data store, but there are other information from other houses, independent. In the independent magazine, a newspaper in the UK has written a story about him before. And then there are other stories about him from South African newspapers and other newspapers that are there. Okay.
Interviews is
granted? Yes, there has been. Foresight. No, we are looking at my documentation. Okay. On the internet. That's what you were talking about in terms of Google. That would be audiovisual. Yes. What about the last category, observation? How will you get that information? You go to a show. Thank you very much. You go to a show and you go and observe yourself. Now what again? Go to the studio, observe him. That could be. See, there's so much qualitative data you can collect. No, that is too far. Yes. You said you had a question. As a researcher, no. You could have been his friend before collecting data, but you don't try to be his friend. You have to be careful that you don't have biases in your data collection.
I think sometimes, even when you get closer to the person, you get to know more.
That is why we say that the qualitative researcher should be aware of his own biases and that he brings to the research, even your own concepts. What if you are a Samini fan? And you are doing a study on Shatawale, it can even affect you. Yes, your question.
Yeah, I was saying that, for example, all the different methods, you could see that if you don't take care, the biases may be reinforced, and then you have the, what I call the bandwagon effect. But if you also adapt the deviant sampling, then you go to people who don't like his music at all. Go and interview, let's say, the preachers, people who feel that
okay. He's
not showing good character.
Now, you can use that if only, one, your research topic is about why he is not loved or accepted. Two, if you want to build a holistic picture about him, those for and those who are against, then that one can use it. But you see, in every study, it doesn't mean that you end up using only one sampling approach. There'll be one which is predominant, and the other ones which can help you to get other information. But you see, if my topic is why something is not like that, then I'm going to go straight to maybe particularly looking at the deviance sampling. But you see, deviance sampling is chosen when you expect a particular way of a particular set of sample elements in a sample to act in this way, and they don't do that. So you want to know why that person didn't do that. And that is what leads up to the deviance sampling. So you try to identify all the elements who, even though they were being paid 100 Ghana, have been able to buy a BMW. You see, there may be very few, but what is it, what is special about them that whilst we are all in the same office, you were able to buy a BMW? That's if you are doing public sector corruption, something like that. So now let me ask a question. Now that what comes into contention is the what comes in contention is the definition of buy. See, you are saying inheritance and all the, does it, is it absorbed in the definition of buy? If the definition of buy is carry money and go and pay, or carry checkbook and go and pay, then that means that it differentiates from what you are saying. Inheritance doesn't come in. Okay. Okay. Then the source of the bite then becomes another issue. See, now you're thinking like qualitative researchers. You're trying to tell me that for every issue there could be multiple perspectives. And that's what we have been trying to emphasize here. Multiple perspectives of the same issue. Okay. Now, with probability sampling, there are different types of sampling. You've got random sampling, which you think you know that how to do random sampling. In a community, here you go and use randomization to pick. But sometimes it's very difficult, especially if you have got an element, a set of elements in a population that are numbered. To be able to get a random, to be able to use randomization or random sampling, then you have to use a random number table. It's a table that you can even Google and get it. It actually arranges numbers in a random manner. So each element can be selected based on what you are selecting from. So if you are selecting from horizontally, you can just choose, you have 97, 1, 5, 82, then you go and select based on what is, how it is arranged on the random number table. However, that means that your elements should have been randomized and numbered like that. Then you can choose from the random number table. How then with the systematic sampling, you are choosing the nth number, the nth person. So, and I think in many primary schools it used to happen, you arrange, you, they want people to sweep the classroom today, say you should all sit in, I sit down, they say 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. So all three stay behind. You are the ones who are sweeping today. So some people are very strategic. They make sure that they are never three. So if the lecturer or teacher changes it to all twos the next time, then you may be. But if you don't take care, every time you may be caught up in the.
We just use it here.
Sorry?
We just use it in this class.
Really? Oh, okay. All threes and all twos. Okay. Okay. Then you also have stratified sampling. Now, stratified sampling means that you have got the people divided into stratas, and then you can be able to select from a given strata. Let me give an example. Supposing there are 20,000 students in University of Ghana, and you want to select 200, but then you hear from the Dean of Students that 10% of the 20,000 students are foreign students. So that 200 you are selecting, you also have to make sure that 10% of that foreign students are what? Are foreign students. So what you have to do is that you are going to separate the how many do you need to be foreign students into 10% of 20 is what? Of 200 is 20. So 20 students are supposed to be how many? For instance, select the 20 from the 10% of the 20,000, and then select the rest of the 180 from the Ghanaians. Otherwise, if you are just selecting 200 from just the 20,000, you can go a number of times that you never get any foreign student. I hope you understand me. What you want to stratify sampling, what you want to do is that for the sample that you choose, all the hidden strata are represented within the your sample. If you don't do that and you just go and do random sampling, you can go a number of 10 times and still never get any foreign student in your 200. Yes.
Well, I think this is just a contribution. Mm-hmm. When you talk about the stratified sampling, when you look at the non-traditional export sector, it's broken down into three main subsectors. And so during my info, when I was writing my thesis, I had to ensure that I selected people based on the percentage. The agriculture is the highest, then you have handicrafts, and then you have semi-processed and processed. I think agriculture is the highest, then follows semi-processed and processed, then handicrafts. So based on what I was choosing, I had to choose based on the numbers that I have in the three sectors. But my second, my question here is, Doc, is it possible to use stratified sampling and also use the purposive sampling in this particular research?
Okay, someone will do stratified to be able to understand the different structures that are there. Then within the strata, you use purposive to select the elements in there. So I want my 200, but I want foreign students who are Nigerians. I hope you understand me. So I'll make sure that all the 20 students are Nigerians, and that's very purposive among the foreign students. And the Ghanaians, I want only Ghanaians who are either from Brown-Ahafo or Techima, it's the same thing. Brown-Ahafo or the Northern region. So in that case, I'm also purposive in what I'm trying to do with the Ghanaian students.
So that means in the particular study, you could use the probability sampling.
Yeah. I won't say that. No, I won't say that. I will say that I use stratified sampling and purposive sampling. Those two are not their approaches, they are not the techniques. We want to know the techniques that you used. That is why you take your time and explain that you are doing a multi-stage sampling, in which the first stage you did this, and then the second stage you did that, to be able to satisfy the research questions that you have. Sometimes don't get into certain just jargons and you throw them there, then it becomes problems for you. So I think he has just helped out. Cluster sampling has to do with the fact that there are, in by nature, there are clusters within the particular sample, not stratus. Clusters. Stratus are more of hidden elements within or members within the population. Clusters are actual groups or different categories within the bigger population. For example, a population University of Ghana has either can be clustered by halls of residence, can be clustered by programs of studies, and then can be clustered by colleges, regular and distant. You can cluster them by different groups. In the country, a group of airports can be clustered by the cities and towns that they serve. So if you want to, or even an airport can be clustered by airlines. So that if you are doing exit polls on whether their flight was good, you can have those from Lufthansa, those from the Ghana Air or Ghana Airways, which I don't know which way we are now with that one. Ghana International Airlines. Then those from those from British Airways, and then the Emirates, and then the rest. So you can have them based on the different groups that exist by nature in there. I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. Don't go and create your own name of clusters and then call it that this is a group that exists. It's very difficult for you to find members for them. Techniques come together and they all share elements and belong to an approach. I don't know why. Technique is a subset of an approach.
Technique, okay. I think that's what I want to do. So in this case, it's just like random sampling, systematic, you come and
probability sampling.
Probability sampling.
And sampling, these are techniques that we use.
Technique,
So you it's a technique because you actually are practicing it on the field.
Yes.
That's what you carry out on the field.
So the approach.
They all belong to the probability sampling approach because they all have a known probability of selecting a member. That's why we say there's a qualitative approach and quantitative approach. When you get within qualitative, there are techniques or there are strategies or there are different methods that you use within qualitative. But the general approach is that they all share this idea. I mentioned that strategies usually refer to hidden elements within a given population, which you may never, you may even not come across when you do random sampling. And an example being the fact that if they are very little in terms of the percentage wise, is quite unseen or unrecognized or fairly unknown within a given population. If you are developing a good sample for quantitative research, you want to make sure that all the hidden strata within the particular population is well represented to fit your study. Get it right, to fit your study. So if I want the students in University of Ghana, and my studies about students in University of Ghana, I want to make sure that I've got my foreign students and my non-foreign students, my local students, well represented in the study. And for it to become representative of the sample of the population, if there's 20% of that hidden strata, I'll make sure that 20% is in the population, that in the sample that I choose.
That is the cluster?
No, that's stratified. Yes. But clusters, have got clusters which are already existing. Now, I was saying the University of Ghana has structure, has clusters like by program of study, by halls, or by what? By faculties, yeah. So in that, if I was doing a sampling, I could sample that. If I need 200 students, and they tell me that, let's say by program of study, this study is 200, and there's let's say marketing is, let's use this class, like marketing is about 44 students, accounting is about 30 students, and this and that, and keep on, I can sample. If I select any five and I add up and get to my 200, I've finished. Do you understand what I'm trying to say?
There's cluster.
So if I want 200 students out of the class, I'll just sample the different clusters until I get what? My 200. So I choose this, I choose this, I choose it. So if I do random sampling and I choose this one, I choose this one, I keep on adding, I get my 200, I stop. So that's depending on which clusters you are using. So you still use cluster sampling, and the clusters in the class, these are the clusters that exist. There are about 30 clusters there. But the 30 clusters add up to 1,000 students, and I need only 200. I need only about only four clusters. But there can be only one cluster, that's all the 200. That would be a bias, so I will not want to use that. I hope you understand. You have to know why you're using cluster sampling. It's not just very interesting and for you to just hear it, but most of you are not going to use cluster sampling, but you have to know why you are using which of the sampling approaches.
So if you take, for instance, you are trying to study of parts.
Yes.
And that's the classification of the various levels of parts. You mm-hmm. have to pick from each of the classes.
Mm-hmm.
So that it's not, you're not picking just the big banks and the number. When you do that, will that amount to stratification?
No, it's not. It's, I have to be very careful, because sometimes your research question is what will tell. It's not necessarily just that the nature of the industry or the nature of the population. I remember I was telling you that stratified sampling, if I'm doing a study on a given population and the foreign students are this, if my question is not necessarily about foreign students, my strata could be something different. That's why I said be very careful of how you're answering it. If I was doing a study on, let's say, students living with Ebola, I may be more concerned on where you came from into here to make sure that I get people who came from Guinea, people who came from, so like recently when they traveled, to make sure all those hidden, because if I just take the students, I may get only Ghanaian students. So I want to make sure that all the students who came, who flew into the into campus, let's say after vacation, there could have been Ghanaian students who went out and they are coming back in. So I have to make sure that almost all of them are well represented in the sample. In that case, I'm not concerned about foreign and then local students. I'm more concerned about those who could be hidden, which I may not capture. That's why I'm saying that study your sample, your population very well before you come up with what are the structures inside the population. And refer reference to your research questions that you are asking. Because some things may not be relevant, a relevant strata for you if it doesn't meet the criteria of the studies that you are trying to do.
Okay.
So that's why I'm saying that if please, it will depend more on your question than me just saying that this will represent that. Because you are asking a question about the banks. And if I'm just doing a study on corporate governance in Ghanaian banks, question is that what is my unit of analysis? Is my unit of analysis a Ghanaian bank, just a Ghanaian bank? And I should also know that corporate governance in an SME, in a rural bank will be different from corporate governance in a commercial bank. So I have to be very careful how what I can be able to what, just compare corporate governance on all the banks that way. It will not work. So fundamentally, your question is not well phrased, and that means that it will affect your sampling. It's not your sampling that was wrong. Your question was not well phrased. How can you just compare corporate governance from commercial bank straight to rural bank, then go to savings and loans, then go to microfinance? The measures of corporate governance for each of them will differ. I hope you understand me. In that case, what I will do is that I will do that one for corporate for commercial banks differently, analyze them differently, analyze this differently, analyze them differently, and then see for each of them is factor A of maybe capital structure decisions. Is it relevant for each of them? But capital structure decisions may not be relevant for microfinance. Even before I start the study, I can see it myself. It may be relevant for those who are listed on the Ghana Stock Exchange, but not on all of them. So what question are you asking? What's your unit of analysis before you start thinking about where your sampling is coming from? That's why I was saying that barely, I will never, it's likely, unlikely for me to see many students doing cluster sampling. But it all depends on your study. And please, if you want to use a sampling approach, find studies that have used that sampling approach too. It gives you some ideas and direction. Okay. Yes. Let me take his question first. He was done or something. You see, you are all asking questions on a qualitative, quantitative one, but I'm not a quantitative researcher. I have to also be.
Somehow there was a review which I
okay.
I got a different understanding. I want to see if you can help me correct if I'm wrong.
Okay.
Some of the materials are communicated with the stratified sampling. We are looking at groups that are of, that are not of similar characteristics. For example, we want to state the performance of students in need. And so your respondent said that you have lecturers, students.
Hey, students' performance, you want to look at lecturers?
Yeah, they also play that. Maybe the mode of lecturing could be on the student's field. It's not always the case that if the student fails, the student passes. You have to bring into all the stakeholders, and these stakeholders are not of the same characteristics. Lecturers are a different group from students, and all other stakeholders that play the role, so you can stratify them in that manner. But that of the cluster system, they have similar characteristics. For instance, you want to interview students, as you said, and you group them according to course or program of study. You see that whatever be the case, the underlying matter that they are all students. They are now clustered in different sections, but the stratified one, you have some of the players that are not of similar.
Okay, I'll agree with you for the first part and the second part. The reason is that you yourself began by saying that the people wanted to study a particular thing, and that what they wanted to study led to what stratification that they could have in a sample. So in that case, you're not talking about foreign and then what, and local students. They're more concerned about students and their performance and all the key stakeholders that could play a key role in affecting or influencing the performance of students. So the question informed the stratification. And that is what I was saying, that the question will inform the strategies that you find. But with the clusters will always have similar characteristics. I understand you. Because I said by a program of study, so you see that all of them are in physics, all of them are in science, all of them are in this. Halls of residence, same characteristics. Let me point something out there. You see, you also mentioned something that you have been reading a number of books. That is an interesting thing. Sometimes the books also contradict each other. I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. So I beg you, whenever you are choosing, always be careful that find a published paper in your area and look at the methods and the references they were quoting. Then go backwards and read those references. It helps you. So if they come and are worry you doing your defense, say, oh, can you look at so and so according to so and so? Even if you have found one lecturer who has used it, oh, Kwame and this also used it. They can also always have a defense coming from with methods. I always see that with methods, always find some studies that have used those methodologies so that you can be able to defend yourself. Because somebody may be saying it's not good out of ignorance, not because you are wrong. I'm telling you, as you're starting your PhD, everything that you are using, make sure that you know the stone you're standing on. I think you better understand that one.
Can that be a case where you can have structures in clusters?
From what you say, it's possible.
Because
but why would you want to do a cluster and come back and do a strata? You see, that's why you have to ask yourself, it's not about the words, it's not about the jargons, as he was even pointing out. It's about what is your question. You can't jump here without having a research question. So this is even far away from where you are beginning from. Your question is where you start from. Have your question right, and it will tell you whether for the given population you have to break it down into structures or into clusters or into just doing random and systematic sampling. From day one, if your title is saying in the manufacturing industry, you know where you are going already. From day one, you have to mention, so you know that within that industry, you now have to find whether you're going to do certification or depending on your question. Okay. Now with questionnaire design, the thing you always begin with the concept of having an idea of what you want to do. Everybody will have a research framework that will guide the development of the questionnaire or have some kind of hypothesis in mind that would guide the development of the questionnaire. So by all means, you have to do some primary design of the areas that you are going to explore. You have to have something in mind, either from your hypothesis or from your some questions in mind, the general questions that you want to try and study. Then your other thing that you have to think about is the question wording or sequencing. How are you going to word your questions and how are you going to sequence them? Which question comes first? Which question comes second? Which question is a lead on or is the follow up to what? These are things that we ask ourselves. And then the physical design layout. This is one of the most difficult part of questionnaire design. You have 70 questions. If you don't take care and you just print them, it will be a bulky 10-page document that nobody wants to answer. However, if you do the front and back, reduce font, it may be about only 7 pages or 5 pages. Everybody will like to answer. So sometimes you have to be very, very careful. And sometimes with Likert skill questions, you just want to just list it and just write, do a box. And that will capture all of them. Then to just do each of them with its own set of strongly agree or disagree. So you have to be smart in how you present the questions. So your presentation can even affect a person's view on the questions. This is too much time.
Sometimes people design questionnaires and they do very well them, and some of the questions they might not even use it in the analysis. And I think that it is time consuming. So maybe it's time when you are designing.
Okay, that question
you only ask questions that you know it will be part of your data.
Okay, I'll say yes and no. To tell you the truth, at sometimes when you are beginning the research and you are doing the piloting it, it looks like it may not be relevant. You may get some interesting insights from there as you are doing it. Let me give you an example. Suppose you are doing a study and you are asking that when is your first time you own a car? I hope you understand me. But you're looking at car sales and all kinds of things, and you don't think that somebody may think that that's not an important question. But do you know that it can give you a general demographic of all the people who are there, that almost all your members have owned a car for less than 5 years? But if you didn't ask that question, you do an analysis and somebody can ask you a question that, but do you know that length of ownership of a car can affect perception? Averagely, how many people in your car, in your study, what's the average number of years people own a car? I didn't collect it. Then you can say, it can be biased. What if everybody was in their first time of owning a car? It could make, it doesn't give some credibility, raise some questionability to your the set of studies, findings that you are presenting to us. So some questions may not look important. You may not even use them in analysis, but it gives you some understanding of this, of the descriptives of the data sample, which can inform your study analysis at a point in time. Maybe not now, but later on. So there's always that difficulty of, should I drop, should I keep in? Drop all that is necessary to be dropped. But you also need to make sure that some basis that helps you for the qualification of members for your study should be there. Okay. Now, a pilot survey is generally a small-scale run survey that is run through of the survey that can be used to check your questionnaire coding, method of analysis, and also be able to check the time involved even administering your questionnaire so that you can look at your budget issues. Sometimes you've run the first one, you say it takes 2 hours to run one questionnaire. You know? But always, your first run shouldn't be the judgment of your study. You need to run the questionnaire about 3-4 times, sometimes about 20 times. The reason is, the more you do it, you become conversant with it. So the first one that you use 1 hour, the second one you use 45 minutes. That by the time you get to the fifth one, you are using maybe 35 minutes. And you see, averagely, 35 minutes is needed for answering the question. I hope you understand me. Because sometimes as you are even asking, you are realizing that this one, if I ask, can ask this one 2-in-1, it will solve this one, solve question, this one, this other question. It comes from out of experience by being on the field. It's not just by just asking somebody. Okay. So some of the possible questions that we ask in questionnaire structure is, do you know of any plans? Sometimes you ask questions about being aware of an issue. You can also ask questions to get feelings about an issue, which is not different from awareness. Sometimes you can also ask questions on getting specific answers on specific aspects of the issue. And it doesn't matter whether it's do you or to what extent. I'm just using this as an example. But you can also get questions that are more about reasons. Reasons. Why do you have multiple subscriptions of mobile phone? Then you ask me, if it's a quantitative study, you may have a number of questions there, a number of answers there. You may choose to what extent does he agree that these are the things that influence him to get to more than one phone. Okay. And then how to find strongly how these views are held. These are some of the questions that can come. Now, for pre-coded questions, it comes up when you have got possible answers for the person to choose from. Which of these towns do you come from? But if you're doing qualitative, you are going to have like, why do you choose to live in Kumasi? Or which of these towns do you live in? Somebody can say that it depends on the time of the semester. When I'm doing the semester, I'm living in Accra, near Kwachu, where my hostel is. But when we are outside the semester, I go back to my grandma's place in Kwitia. However, if I'm doing internship, you see, now there are three places that is given. If I'm doing internship, I'm in Tema. When I'm visiting my boyfriend, I'm in Hohoi. So he has given up for 5. But if you just want to ask that, which of these towns do you live in, it will take you there when. But if you are more concerned about students and where they live, where they choose their hostels, you know that you are not concerned about all the hallway and everything. Where do you live in or when you are on campus or when you are in school in session? So it will specify the place and make it easier. That is why quantitative studies are very objective in their questions. If you have a quantitative study and you ask a question like a qualitative question, it doesn't help the questioner or the person who is answering the question or the respondent. You are asking quantitative questions and you are asking it in a way that leaves more possible answers. No, that doesn't help. So you want to be very careful of that. Then please, this is not a good question. How many children do you have? Then start doing 0, 1, 2, 3, up to 7. Come on. What if he has more than 7? So it's better that you make it more categorical. 0 to this, something to that, something to that. So that at least, that's interval. Yeah, I said categorical, this is more categorical. So that you can ask for them to choose. Which of these you belong to? Good. Now, how do you biases in wording of your questions? Do you use self-service garages because they are easy to use and clean? Now, this is a double barrel question. What is easy to use is not easy to clean. And what is easy to clean is not easy to use. I hope you see that. What is easy to use is not easy to clean. And what is easy to clean is not easy to use. But we do that a lot. We put two questions in one. Okay, questions that contain difficult or unfamiliar words. Where do you usually shop? This is a qualitative question, me answered in a quantitative way. Where do you mean usually? It depends on the time of the year. I know a lady who buys her Christmas provisions from UK. You put it in chop box and bring it. Physical, the chop box that we used to take to school. I said he doesn't eat provisions from Ghana. So we're barrel. Okay. Then look at this one. Question that starts with whether I'm meant to soften hardness or directness. I hope you do not mind me asking, but are you a virgin? And these are issues that happen on the field a lot. Now, if you have issues, questions that are going to be sensitive, you don't ask them in the questionnaire like this. You tell the person when before you start asking starting the whole study, there are certain questions will center on sexuality. Will you want me to ask you or not? So that you know that you avoid that area. Now, if you don't take care, this person now gets confused. Should he say no or should he say yes? If you say, he says, I don't want to answer, it also has implications. So if you I don't want to ask implications. But you know, as a researcher, if you are qualitative, you're not supposed to delve in too much. Your biases can happen. But if you're quantitative, you just take your yes and no and go away. But you see, the problem here is that if there's the person feels uncomfortable, it affects the rest of the questionnaire. You will answer them all. So you want to be very, very careful when you're asking questions like that. The questions will contain conditional or hypothetical clauses. How do you think your life would change if you had 9 children? How many people have even thought about this in life? For them to you to try to put them into that state. And we do that a lot. We try to put people into a state that what will happen if you had 1 million cities? Come on. No, these are very issues that we face on the field. We are asking questions as if the person is in that state already. He's not in that state, so don't ask such a question.
So what you mean is that we should not be asking useless questions.
Now, how do you define a question to be useless? For all you know, you could have asked the same question about in another way. For example, if I'm doing a study and somebody's asking me about polygamy and about childbirth and about sexual behavior in a community where we know that that community, everybody minimum is 7. Asking a question that, what do you think your life would change if you had 9 children? It might not be, but the minimum is 7 in the community from statistics that you had from the healthcare centers there before you went to ask them. But if in a community that they are saying that even 1 is an issue, why would you want to go and ask this question about? So your question should be reflected to what you are doing and then your population, that context you are asking the questions from. If you don't take care and the culture, thank you. If you don't take care, you go to some community, ask some questions, you never come back. Because you are not sensitive to the issues in the community. Okay. Now look at this. This is also what a lot of finance and accounting students do. If you take your weekly income after tax, and when you have made other allowances for all regular bills, how much have you left to spend? You want the respondent to turn into a calculator and be calculating these things in front of you. There's one question I met in another study. What is your proportion of... do you do one job? If you don't do one job, what is the proportion of sales that come from job A and then job B and the other jobs? So the person should sit there and say, okay, job A gives me 10% of my income, job B gives me 30%. I'll say, what? Why don't you just ask that? How much do you earn from A in terms of income and then B and C? When you go home, you can add it and get a calculated value and get it as the sum, then calculate your portions. Because even the percentage, even translating percentage in other languages, is difficult. Like in Chinese, which is 100, by the time you finish, you may even get, you confuse the person with your bad Ghanaian language. Because you couldn't translate it well. Now the question is not even well asked. So please be very, very careful when you are having the language barriers in your questions. So how do you structure a questionnaire, especially for qualitative? Qualitative questionnaires always start from what we call field notes. Field notes is necessary. When you get to the field, what you saw, what was happening, the time, the weather. Some of the things may not be important at that time, but when you go home and do analysis, it can help you a lot. Now, the weather is important, especially if you are doing market women, farmers, because the time of the day when they answer the question. And if you are doing religious questions and you interviewing people on Friday, maybe Muslims are going to pray and you are going at 1 o'clock, you appear there at 12:30. It doesn't make sense. So you should know that they are in a hurry. So the answers they are giving to you may be skewed or may be given hurriedly. So some of the issues may not be as detailed as they wish they could have done. So please, the time of the day, they recall the time, the date, the description of the natural settings is important for qualitative research. Then in introduction of the research, aim at the interviewee. For those who are doing organizational studies, like you're talking about Casa Preco, you may go and leave your questionnaire and go back again before you start your questions. So it means that by the time you appear the next time, they would have done read through your questions. Some of them would have even started filling it for you. So that's quite easy. Now, others could have also read through, but when you come, they want to go through every question with you and give you their view. So you have to also keep that in mind. Now, in that case, if you have already given the person an introductory letter, the person would have understood the letter, the study. But if you have not done it, you may have to introduce yourself. But please, sometimes introducing yourself from University of Ghana helps. Sometimes it doesn't help. So you have to be with smartness. I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. I went to a place where doing collecting data. I said, oh, some people from University of Ghana came here last week. We gave them the answers. Go and ask them. They just shut us down just like that. It didn't lead to anything. I didn't know. So I showed up and they said, oh, that's the kind of language. They see you as elite people. So you always come and disturb them, and we didn't see any outcome. And for all you know, they promised them something and you didn't really know about what they promised. And you see, they see Legon as one big place that we are all doing the same thing. So when you show up, they just brand you with the Legon title. Maybe it's better to show us Tech, KNUSC, maybe in this time. Or maybe IPS, anyway. But what I'm trying to say is that you want to be very careful how you introduce yourself. That is why doing a recognizance is important. Go and find out before you start your studies. Find out. Some people don't like researchers at all. Some people too are very open to research. So try to do some find out some studies yourself. That's why I said to quite a number of people that it's good that sometimes you go there as a client for the same activity that you want to experience, so that you can have an idea about what is going on there. Then if there are some key terms that you need to define, please you tell them. If there are some sensitive parts of the questionnaire, you have to tell them then now. So that you know that if they are uncomfortable about it, you can escape it. Don't let a question push them away from answering the questions or put them off. Sometimes some questions about finance, how much you earn, you can even take it to the end. When you are finishing the study, then you ask them those study questions, then they can answer you. Because especially if they are very deal with privacy. I remember somebody's study that he was doing, he was asking questions on how entrepreneurs manage their companies and the gender differences in that. And he wanted to ask questions on gender violence. That was the very last question. So after everything, he asked that, have you experienced any gender violence in your home before? Did it affect your work? Then you see, so that if he doesn't want to answer, it doesn't affect the whole study. Okay, demographics. Every questionnaire will always have some demographic questions. Age, name, some very basic marital status. Please, let me teach something here. Qualification is not educational level. I want to know, let's explain. Qualification is the one that you completed and they give you some evidence, paper, if only the rain didn't take it away. Some evidence you finish. This is a big problem we have in a lot of, they think qualification is the same as educational level. Educational level is where you are now. So your educational level is PhD, but your qualification may be your master's or unless other any tertiary degree you have finished. I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. So we usually mix the two. You have to know why you're asking educational level. That's if you want to get the person's knowledge and intellect and how it informs what he's doing. But if you want to get skill which you bring to the work, then you want qualification. The skill that you bring to the work. That's why you can even ask whether you have a vocational qualification. Then vocational qualification does not mean that is less or higher than tertiary, because somebody can be in tertiary and still go for a vocational qualification. For example, you are talking to caterers and you can have a caterer who just came from JSS and did catering course and a caterer. You can have a person who has finished PhD and he was also a caterer, but his highest qualification will be PhD, but for relevance for the job, he needs catering. you can understand me. So please, those questions, if you're asking it, sometimes think about your research questions and your target respondents first. Don't be just in a rush of just asking the question. In the same way, with marital status, we have got married, single, cohabiting. That is the one that we usually drop, cohabiting. And if you're doing studies with those who are in the bottom of the pyramid, a lot, there are a lot of cohabiting. So if you go and go to Wawarewa now, or Warim by Meninneti, then you see it's cohabiting. Don't go and get children that's married. It affects your analysis later. Because when you look at cohabiting, access to inheritance, access to certain rights at home or in the business can be skewed or can be different than somebody who is married. Decision-making rights can be different than somebody who is married. So cohabiting, then you have got what? Divorce, and then you said something again. Yeah, then they're separated too. Then they're separated. Before divorce, they're separated. They have not divorced, but they are separated. Then there's widow, and then... So there's also single, but not available. Maybe if you do a study on singles, then you can ask the different strata of singles. Okay. Then there are... So from there, you go to demographics concerning the company or household. If you're doing a household study, you want to define what a household is. You see, if you go to some regions, household can be very, very large. So you have to know what you call a household. You know that GLSS is made out of household studies, 18,000. So you should understand what a household is. So sometimes it's okay, it's good for you to fall on some statistical data in Ghana, like the GLSS data, the Ghana Living Standards Survey, the six that is out. You can look at them and then look at some of the statistics on the community you are going to or the region you are going to. Gives you some idea how many people, how many households are in that community. Some students also just pick the same set of parameters that they were using in the enumeration areas that they selected. So for every region, there are areas that they collect the data from. They collect the same thing from the same areas. Because if you are able to get the raw data, you can compare the time they went and that same household you go in there. Some students do that. I've seen some students do that before, where they compare the data they collected with the data they collected, what was collected by Ghana Statistical Service, to be able to see what the differences have come in terms of income in that same home. So they know the unit number for that particular, or the ID of that home, and they go to that same home to do a kind of a panel study. So you have that data as your beginning of your panel, and your data then becomes the end of the panel. So please, it's possible to use existing data, which is well collected like that in Ghana. The main questions. Key question sections may stem from the themes, concepts, and variables in your research framework. So please, I always encourage that every section, every key question or every key variable in your research framework should have a section. So you should have, if you have got something on motivation, there should be motivation there, and the questions on motivation should come. If there's a section on, let's say, attitude, then the questions on attitude will come. Knowledge, the question of knowledge will come. So have the questions there. Because if you don't do that, we ask ourselves that, how are you collecting the data from those variables? Especially some students just like mixing everything up, saying that they'll have to do some factor analysis to find out. I don't have a problem. So far as you know what your questionnaire is doing in relation to your methods you're going to use for analysis, we make sure that all the questions that are relevant for your variables are well asked. If you're doing a likelihood scale question, at least you know that you should have a minimum of 3 questions for each of the variables. And they should be mutually exclusive. It means that each of them, is it right? Mutually exclusive, yes. Each of them should be independent, measuring something. Not that they all measure the same thing. Otherwise, you have yes, 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 or strongly agree throughout, which does not give you a very good measure in terms of your analysis. Okay. Then you should also have some questions may come up from the questions that you are asking. The new variables can show up, especially with qualitative. As you are talking to the person, maybe she may say one or two things that you didn't capture. So you have some other impromptu questions that can come up, or new questions that you can come up out of follow-ups, which I will encourage you to look out for them. If you are doing quantitative, there's very little room for that because you are not interviewing the person one-on-one. But some quantitative studies leave some small section for you to provide some few other comments that may be necessary. Other quantitative studies also add the word other. They have their variables, but other, everything, other. So that is, if there's anything that is mentioned that you didn't factor it in it, you can put it in other and then put it there. Even like a skill, you can have other there. For example, what are the reasons that, what influenced you to start a company or start your enterprise? I lost my job to supplementary income. Just to find, I have a hobby, something like that. Then it goes on in your other. So maybe in case there's something that is captured, mentioned, that you didn't put across in your questionnaire, you can be able to do that by using the other. Okay. If you have too many others to it, it affects your analysis. Anyway. Then impromptu questions and observations. Qualitative studies, we want you to capture your observations, things you are seeing. There are certain questions that if you ask, the person sits up and wants to answer it very well. Other ones, you tell that, okay, you let's keep it and we'll come back to it. You see, capture all these mannerisms because it tells you where the truth is being told and where the truth is not being told. It also tells you where they are comfortable with and what they are not comfortable with. So please look out for those ones. Then in your conclusion, you are going to review your answers and future review. Please, don't promise anything if your work is not going to do anything. Don't go and say that it will bring money by this, the findings will be used by government to come and improve the community, when you don't have any idea of how your study will even reach the regional minister. Or maybe the time it even reached him, he has been changed, reshuffled. So please, I will advise you, don't promise what you can give. Some people like to give 5 CDs or airtime for their participation. Now, if you keep on doing that in a particular community, everybody will line up for questionnaire. So you want to be very, very careful. Others buy lunch. That one, if you don't take care, it can also affect your studies. Just be wise and see. Sometimes it's better you finish everything before you give any incentive. And practically, there are some places that you have to enter to do the studies. You can't, because of time, you may have to do it with a research assistant. So you have to train your research assistant to understand the questionnaire just as you understand it. So that you are on the field with the research assistant and he's collecting data from A and you are doing B. Yes.
What if you ask a question and you know obviously the person is telling lies? What do you do?
How do you know?
An obvious case, maybe you are doing the survey in an area, maybe supposed to be a high class area, and then you go to meet a caretaker. We are talking about maybe low consumption. You know it's a caretaker. Maybe he even agrees that it's a caretaker. You ask him how many maybe things of low consumption and then he tells you it.
There's something I needed to mention in the beginning of the questionnaire design. Anytime you are designing a questionnaire, this part, the first part, field notes, you should have something we call respondent and the characteristics of the respondent. Not just about age and things, but about who the respondent is in relation to the study. For example, in a study of enterprises, you can have the owner, but actively managing the company. You can have an owner not in active management. And you can also have a person who is a manager, but not an owner. And then you can also have a caretaker and not a manager or an owner. So you need to make sure that your respondent's characteristics are outlined. So if it's a quantitative study, it is better you have all the possibilities and you take the person. What person is it in position in relation to the enterprise you're asking the questions on? If it's a household, what the person is in relation to that household? Because it helps you to be able to know that in the real face value of the data you have, how many of this data is coming from real owners of the enterprise? That can even give you that people who are saying that they own the enterprise say that the key problem to constraint to expansion is finance. However, when you bring in those who are not owners but they are actively managing, they can say that the key problem they are finding to expansion is space. I hope you can understand what I'm trying to explain here. So the type of ownership and the persons in relation to the study can affect some of the responses. So it's important you capture it, both qualitative and quantitative. Sometimes you may not see important now, it may not be looked as important as of now. But when you're doing analysis, then you start looking and seeing some findings look very funny, or they look as if that it doesn't sound true. And that could happen. Yes, you go back to your own data and you ask yourself, why does it look like it's not conclusive? Like you have a data that somebody is saying that he has, like, he consumed 8 bottles of milk. Go and check whether the person has a family size of this. See, that's simple checks for it. You just check the family size corresponding to the number of milk he's drinking a week. Now, how can somebody have 8 bottles a week and then say a family size of 2? Maybe a cat, cats and dogs in the house. Now the further check would have done after you collected your data. You drop that data. But if that's why we collect phone numbers, you can call and clarify. For all you know, some of the rich people have 2 houses in one. But the guy is the one taking care for the 2 houses. So he reported data for the house A, but for buying things, he's reporting for the 2 houses. Yeah, some of them they build it just with a barrier between the 2, but it's the same one compound. Or the children are in school and the time the children are home. So when all his 8 children are now on their boarding houses, the pressure at home is 1 milk per person a week. But when they are all back, you see, then time that becomes an issue. So you want to be very, very careful and try to, you can do follow-ups. Sometimes it is you, when you're reporting, you are recording, you are writing 5 and you wrote 8. So the guy who was interpreting or inputting the data for you is the one who didn't type it well. I've seen people try to type 1 and write 10. Yeah, and if you don't take care, it looks like this becomes very interesting. There's a peak. All of a sudden, there's a peak at some place. There's something wrong with this variable. You go and trace and see that, the guy was writing 10 in root. And that can be very difficult. Like I have a Likert scale. You know, Likert scale is numbered from 1 to 5. And you do a mean. And you have when you do the descriptives, you have a 1 descriptive, we say the lowest value is 1, and the highest value is 7. The thing is up to 5. How can the highest value be 7? Means that the guy who was typing made a mistake. So this is when your data cleaning comes in. Last year when you did quantitative, didn't they teach you data cleaning? Didn't you collect your own data and go through how to clean data, how to put your data together? Those of you who are in the class, were you not in the class?
Yeah, we didn't get it.
So please, when you finish everything, say thank you. It's important. Say thank you. That's after you have left there and you have transcribed and everything. Don't send text messages. Otherwise, they will start collecting other data from you. So please, officially, either send an email or write a letter and drop it at the reception and turn away and go. Yes. If you report it just anywhere, it will go against you ethically.
Yeah, give me your number and I will put your name, or I'll put your number in there.
Random.
And a random.
For airtime.
For something.
Oh, people do that. People do that. That one is also welcome for you to do. I think you want to try all the measures that can help you get higher response rates. Yeah. But you want good responses. That's what you want to look at. Okay. There are different ways you can be able to design surveys online. You can go to SurveyMonkey. There's another one called Qualtrics. So SurveyMonkey and Qualtrics can help you. SurveyMonkey can do some basic questionnaire design for free. Or you can go to Qualtrics. Qualtrics is more robust and helps you do analysis. But they are online platforms for administering questionnaires. That's if you're going to collect data from people who are online. And there are quite a number of tutorials too online. After that, you can type it in Google for survey tutorials. There's quite a lot. But remember, if you're doing quantitative study, you survey. If you're doing qualitative, it's not survey. So don't go and do a survey questionnaire for a qualitative study. So this will brings us to the end of understanding methodology. I've tried to cover it as much as possible for the qualitative part and parts of the quantitative.